If you're an aspiring filmmaker, I think you should be watching micro-budget films. And here's why. We spend most of our life watching these big budget blockbuster movies or even indie films like, you know, A24 films, which I love. But the truth is most of those movies are made with a decent amount of money. Now, like relative, some of these indie movies have way, way less of a budget than these $100 million Marvel movies. Still, relative to what we have, if we're working with pretty much no budget at all, maybe a couple $1,000s, that's a huge, huge gap there. So today I want to look at 10 films that I think you should check out as a micro-budget filmmaker that do a lot with a little. And let's look at some of the patterns and the things we see in those movies. And I've capped it at $100,000 as the most expensive. I know even that is a crazy amount of money. I don't have $100,000 to go out and make a movie, but we had to set the bar somewhere. Let's start with Upstream Color. This is by Shane Carruth, and the budget, $50,000 to $100,000 is what I found online. It's a really, really interesting, weird film. That's something you should take note of. What you don't want to do as a micro-budget filmmaker is try to emulate a blockbuster movie on your micro-budget level, because you're going to do the same thing as these big blockbuster movies, but you're not going to do it very well. What you should do is embrace the fact that you don't have a whole lot of money. Do something different that a studio movie might not be able to do. Get kind of weird with it. It was shot on this camera, which I don't even use anymore, and it looks beautiful. Granted, I'm sure they used really great lenses, but still, work with the camera you have, even if it's an iPhone. I mean, Steven Soderbergh uses an iPhone, and he's a big Hollywood filmmaker. All right, next we got Pi, budget $60,000. This is Darren Aronofsky's first film. You know him from films like Black Swan, The Wrestler, Mother, Noah, The Fountain. I watched this in college, so I don't have the most fresh memory of it. I remember liking it in that it was just really weird and psychological. Maybe not as good as some of his other films, but for the budget, really impressive. Next we have The Godfather of found footage. It's The Blair Witch Project. That was made for $60,000 and launched basically a whole genre of films. I'm kind of curious what that money went to, because I feel like if you made that movie now, it could be made for less. Not sure. Next we have Coherence, budget $50,000. And this might be my favorite film on the whole list. It all takes place in a single location with a group of friends, and basically this comet's going over the house and things get weird and really complicated. And I just really enjoyed it. It has a lot of tension. It does look like it was shot for not a ton of money, you know, but that's because they shot it in 5 days. So the lighting setup is sort of a 360 setup that they could shoot it anywhere in the house and it would look decent. And that allowed them to work pretty quickly. Next, we have Krisha with a budget of $30,000. And that was made by Trey Edward Schultz. And he's gone on to make It Comes at Night and Waves. And this movie was picked up by A24. It's kind of a dark family drama, but really well done. Trey stars in it himself. And basically, he shot this in one of his family members' homes. The premise of the film is that there's like a Thanksgiving reunion happening. But basically, he cast his family in the film, mostly family members. And I guess they apparently have an acting gene in their family because everybody is pretty good. And the film looks good. It's really well done on the budget. Next, we got Resolution. I just watched that this last week, and it's by Aaron Moorhead and Justin Benson. This film is right up my alley. It's got weird psychological mystery sci-fi elements to it. And it stars two guys, pretty much a single location. It's more like an area than one single place. A lot of it takes place outdoors or using natural light in this indoor setting. Really good film. They actually did a follow-up called The Endless that kind of ties into this movie. That one was also done for a really low budget. I'm not sure if it actually fits into this list because the budget isn't listed online. That one stars a lot bigger cast and does have more locations. Next, we got Primer, another film by Shane Carruth. And I feel like this is the one that most people think of and talk about when they talk about doing so much with so little, and rightly so, because the film stars two guys and it's a time travel movie and it's just crazy complicated. You can't really follow all the threads, and that's part of the point of it, I think. And I think most of this budget actually went to buying 16 millimeter film. That's what this was shot on. So it looks decent, even though it's always not nicely lit. Film kind of gives you a little bit of a forgiving look on that kind of stuff. Anyways, definitely check that one out. And then we have Following, the thing that launched Christopher Nolan's career. This one's really, really short, 68 minutes. You can see in this film the early Nolanisms, if you will, the sort of non-linear editing of the film. It stars three characters, limited locations. Definitely check out the director's commentary if you can on this movie. There's a lot of great insights Christopher Nolan gives. One of them being that he placed his actors near windows a lot. That gave nice, pleasing light and meant they didn't have to set up so many lights for all of the scenes. It's a pretty good tip in general. For the opening, I remember he talked about that they made that scene in kind of a quiet setting and really focused on having good audio for the first scene in the movie so that hopefully you would just get immersed in the film and you might not notice some of the audio issues that were happening later in the film. Next, we got the battery with a budget of $6,000, two baseball players in a zombie apocalypse setting, and they're mostly just hanging out, and it's, you know, more focused on the character than it is on the zombie killing. Again, they do things in this movie that a studio movie probably wouldn't do. You see weird, interesting aspects of these specific guys' experience in the zombie apocalypse and how it affects them. And last, we have Creep. And I could not find an exact number on this budget, but it looks pretty close to zero if you watch the film. It does have Mark Duplass, which is a big name in it, but he was, you know, involved in the making of the film. The whole film is Mark Duplass and another guy, and it's kind of done in a found footage style, but with the premise that the main character is actually a videographer, so it ties well into the film. They made a pretty creepy film for not a whole lot of money. Okay, so what are some patterns we notice looking at these films? The big three things I see is limited cast, limited locations, and the genres. For cast, a lot of times it's going to be two people, maybe three people, and that's about it for the main characters. And that's because, you know, you have to shoot coverage if you're going to have multiple characters. You have to think about multiple schedules for people, and that's going to take more time to work around everybody's schedules. You have to make sure everybody's well fed, and that costs more money. And on the flip side of that, there's locations. You know, every time you move a location, that costs money and that takes time. You have to set up the lighting. You might have to rent more gear for that specific location. Now, there's a balance with that, with coherence. You know, that film has quite a few characters, but it really is like a single location. And on the other hand, you have Primer, where there is a decent amount of locations, but it's two guys, and they're reusing locations because of the time travel aspect. The other thing is genre. You're going to see a lot of horror and sci-fi and, you know, psychological mystery films on this list. Part of that is because that's what I'm into, but there's also a built-in audience for those types of film. The story itself is what people are really interested in, and they want to know, like, the mystery of the film or be caught up in the suspense of the film, whereas, you know, drama films, a lot of times you're not going to watch that unless there's a big name actor in it. Other thing that I see on here a lot is the runtime from the films on here, I think, ranges from 68 minutes to 102 minutes. So definitely try to keep that film at 100 minutes or less, maybe 80, 90 is that sweet spot, because every minute of the film, that just means more shooting and that means more money. You know, the main thing you want to keep in mind if you want to make a micro-budget film is you have to think like a producer when you're writing the script. The actual script screenwriting phase is just so important for how the film actually comes out, because you need to be realistic with your expectations. Try to work with what you have and just pretend that you have no money to work with, even if you, you know, maybe have a budget of a couple thousand dollars. It's going to disappear so quickly with just feeding people, maybe renting things, all the little miscellaneous expenses, that money's going to be gone. So don't budget things into the script that are going to cost a lot of money. That's all I have for you today. Let me know if I missed any big micro-budget films on this list that you think I should check out, and I'll see you next time.